I'm an engineer that I've never worked in the field he has studied. I consider myself as an actor here. I introduce me like this because I think it's important. You might have some question a little bit more academic. I'm happy to discuss it if I can. But that's not my background, and that's not the way I approach the subject today. I'm more what I call myself a freelance activist today. I used to lead an NGO confederation in Europe called Concorde, which was the European Confederation of Development and Humanitarian NGOs based in Brussels. The headquarters were based in Brussels. So that's my background. And the subject is a little bit borderline between academy and practice. So we'll try to move from one field to the other as much as possible. I think we need to keep that connection. This is why I suggested you two short readings. Now, let be frank, because I think it's better for me to capture a little bit your understanding of the subject. Who have read the longer document, which was a kind of 10 pages? It doesn't matter if nobody did it, okay? I don't mind. It's just for me to know the level of detail. I can refer to the article or not. So who? I've seen three shy hands. Okay, so 3% out of the so I can refer a little bit more in detail to the to this reading that I suggest you, if you are interested by the subject, to look at it, because I think it's a good synthesis of what I would like to share with you today. And the other one was a much more boring, traditional kind of UN description from the Guardians, but it's a blog sponsored by the Melinda and Bill Gates Foundations on development, global development issues. And it was just an introduction to the SDGs. So if I say SDGs, second question, who has heard these words? SDGs, Sustainable Development Goals. That's almost all of you have heard about it. Have you had some discussion during the courses so far on the Sustainable Development Goals agenda? A little bit? Okay. Also to understand how deep we should go or not, okay? So that was the second reference I proposed to you, which was a description, very institutional, of what is the content of those development goals, which are 17 goals approved by the UN in the last General Assembly in September 2015, okay? And we are supposed to capture kind of a broad international agenda on sustainable development. But I won't start by this narrow kind of institutional angle. I would like to open it a little bit broader from the other article, which was bringing back, and in 1 hour it's not easy to get a fair picture of sustainable development, but I would like to start there, okay? What does it mean for you? What does it mean for me, for us actors from the civil society field? And perhaps we can bring some other actors' perspective into the discussion, but I would like to start by this. It's a so usually, frequently used concept, sustainable development. Everybody referred to sustainable development, that I would like to see how we can clarify a little bit what we understand and what it means. I had to decide between different approaches to start with. One which would be a more academic discussion around the sustainable development concept. Another one that could come from the international negotiation on sustainable development, which is another reading of the process, and another one from the diversity of actors. But I decided to not choose none of them, but to bring a little bit the three perspectives. So where the concept comes from in terms of academy discussion, how it has been relayed by institution through the so-called international UN negotiations, and third, what kind of actors are positioning themselves in front of different meanings of sustainable development. Well, so that's a little bit the framework. Is it clear so far? More or less? and interrupt me. I'm a discussant. That's how I see myself, and I want a discussion with you. I'm happy to start the first introduction, but I'm more interested by a direct discussion with the two respondents, but also widely with all of you. So I think it's an interesting issue, and let's make it interesting and lively. So if I take it from a more academic point of view, it seems that there are several milestones in the last 40 years in the discussion around sustainable development. The article I proposed you to read referred to one of the perhaps first efforts to deepen a little bit what sustainable development would mean was in 1972, last century, through a global conference which was held in Stockholm, called the Stockholm Conference on Human Environment. So it was even not yet directly on sustainable development, but it was called on human environment, which was for the first time trying to bring together the discussion of human well-being and environmental issues. And that's highlighting the conflict, because from the very beginning it has been by the academy described as a conflict between the concept of development and the concept of environment. And since there we are still trying to assess if it's a real conflict, if it's compatible or incompatible. And I hope we'll get some views on that after this exchange. So that's the starting point where at international level some academic people raised those issues. Then 8 years later, in 1980, I'm not sure, I think IUCN already existed at that time, but IUCN is the International Union for Conservation and Nature, which is a unique organization that I don't know if you have heard about IUCN, never before. So IUCN is a sui generis organization. It's not an international institution, nor an NGO. It's an alliance with its own statutes, rules, and management, governance, etc., which regroup three kind of actors. Almost today, at least, 2,000 experts on conservation and nature. Almost 200 Ministry of Environment. Well, I don't know if each country of the UN has a dedicated environment ministry, but the assumption is every country counting with an institution dealing with environmental issues bring one member into this cluster of ministries, and then you have like 800 NGOs. And all together, they create this international union called IUCN. So that's interesting in terms also of governance, because you have, since decades, governments, experts, which might represent academy, science, and then NGOs. So IUCN in the 80s, issued a report raising the impact of development in the use of natural resources. And that was the first time that a broad global report was issued with evidences and facts on the impact of development on environment and nature. The third milestone at academy level from the author of the article I shared with you, is led by the US National Academy of Sciences, who issued in 1995 another report and created a board of scientists on sustainable development. So here we are clearly on sustainable development as a concept. And they have, in a way, tried to deepen what we understand by sustainable development and creating, I would say, even the referential for sustainable development. And the fact that it comes from the US in this context has also some impact in the debate even still today. at the same time, alors, interestingly, this board on sustainable development from the Academy, Science Academy of the US, was looking at 2050, so we were 1995, 2050 as the minimum kind of period of time where we could refocus our development patterns and models to get sustainability. So that was interesting because they were considering that you would need two generations to achieve a shift from the former economical model to a more sustainable development one. A third initiative, or well, not third, but at least it's the fourth step, but it's the same year, more or less 95. Another group from the Stockholm Environment Institute, the same that hosted in 72, the first milestone I mentioned, the first report issued on human environment. They came back, led by scientists from all over the world, but also a lot of Nordic leadership, under the leadership of the Nordic countries, with what they called the Great Transition. It was a group working on global scenarios. So they were doing like long-term scenarios and they called their work the Great Transition. And this is important because this is one of the references we worked with today as NGOs. I will come back a little bit on our work as an actor. Paul Raskin, for example, is one of the people who today are leading a little bit the thinking about the Great Transition. And interestingly, in a way, the Great Transition is very interesting as a concept because it tried to challenge very explicitly, perhaps among all the references I mentioned, the one that more explicitly challenged the fact that there is no way to reach sustainable development without reassessing the economical model. And even challenging the fact that development is compatible with sustainability. So that's perhaps the more idealistic, perhaps, work on the sustainable development. And we will come back a little bit later on that. What does it mean? Where does it start, etc. And then, of course, since the year 2000 and a little bit earlier, you have these climate panels. How do we call it in English? International panel leading the climate negotiation, or at least enforcing and informing the climate negotiation from the government, the COP21 and all the previous COPs are based, as you know, on the work of this international network of more than 2,000 scientists that works on climate. And of course, they are bringing a lot of elements and evidences and new concepts on, of course, sustainable development, what should be done and not to go for a post-carbon society. So those are a little bit the main references that I found in terms of academy when it comes to sustainable development. When it comes to another perspective to look at this issue is to look at who within civil society have been trying to work with the concept of sustainable development. And here you have also a very broad and diverse history, background of initiatives that are convergent, but not fully. And that's also why this issue is so interesting. So you have, to start with, a traditional, and this is perhaps the oldest, I called it a neo-Marxist, lefty, whatever you want to call it, but you know, the kind of historical social movements, very focusing on human justice. And I think the main, if you want a key word to characterize all those movements from civil society is the call for more justice. And there is many campaigns, many movements, even movements on ecology, but not fair trade, which is a very much NGO kind of related movement, but calling for trade justice and not fair trade, you know? So we can come back a little bit on the nuances between, for example, those two terms, no? Justice, trade justice and fair trade. But these movements are still very active. They are led by very grassroots movements. The farmers' organization from Brazil, for example, have been leading a lot of work on those issues. You have the traditional trade unions, of course, and new initiatives, mainly from the South, what the so-called South, no? More than from our own Western societies. Then you have the human rights movements that came into those discussions over the 90s through the so-called social rights, cultural rights, and environmental rights, the last generation of rights, which are supposed to be the rights of nature. And that's very interesting to see how these historically very active and powerful movements came into the discussion more recently around sustainable development because of this last generation of tending to acknowledge that the nature has some rights, right to be protected, rights to be diverse, etc. You have, of course, the core of the social movement around environment issues that have been traditionally leading a little bit the work on sustainable development. But from our perspective, I come, as I told you, with a perspective which is the next point on global solidarity movement, with a perspective which is a little bit too narrow to nature. But they have been, of course, defending the case of the attacks of the current economical model to nature, raising a lot of issues and advancing the agenda very, very powerfully. So environmental movements are today a key actor in all those discussions, with also two trends. One which is perhaps more embodied by some US or American, broadly speaking, based organization, which is to make the case that we need to protect environment. They argue that we should give an economical value to nature, which is a way to monetarizing nature, to make it kind of market commodities as others, and that would be regulated because and protected because they have a value, an economical value. And then in the rest of the world, to make it a little bit stereotypized, but you have other movements, environmental movement, that would like nature to be acknowledged for its intrinsic values and not for the economic values we would, as human, give it in this market-oriented world. Then you have the movement I come from, which is the global solidarity movement or international solidarity movement, or I don't like this name, but the aid, traditional kind of international aid industry, which is based on the development cooperation, the international development cooperation, which is the old sector, which started in the 60s more or less with humanitarian aid and then more long-term development aid and all those questions. Yeah, and of course for us, sustainable development is a key issue that we brought into the loop of institutions, public opinion and other actors from the perspective of the fight against poverty. Again, it's a little bit stereotype, but the way we approach things and our own agenda is from an anti-poverty approach. And I would like also to mention another very active and not very visible sector in the civil society world, which is linked to your morning discussion on gender, which is the women movements, who are very strong around the sustainable development issues, much stronger than what usually the other actors acknowledge. And they might be the women organizations, feminist movement, new feminist organizations, they are strongly advocating in favor of a kind of great transition approach, which is questioning the current economical consumption production patterns much more explicitly than the traditional NGOs, for example. So I think we should keep it in the loop if you are interested by what women organizations are saying about that. There are many, many work done. Okay, so that's after a kind of academic, kind of very quick panorama, you have a little bit the diversity of civil society actors. I should add certainly, but we don't consider that's our choice. You can question it later if you want, but we don't consider private sector as a civil society actor. We consider it as a third actor on its own. And of course, private sector could be brought into the loop because for them, sustainable development, which is not a natural issue, became, over the last few decades, very important, at least communication issue, sometimes economic issue, but for the moment mainly a marketing and communication issue, which obliged them to take some initiatives also at UN level. If you want, we can talk later about what the private sector is trying to do on its own to bring back the sustainable development agenda in their own sector. And finally, in this kind of broad picture about where the sustainable development is discussed, where it's come from, who is pushing for it or discussing it, we need to bring this question of the international negotiations. Because it is part of this 40 years old process in putting sustainable development in the loop of our decision makers. Because you could have forever some academy and civil society discussing on their own, totally disconnected from the rest of society. But at one stage, if you want to have a more political kind of struggle or contact in society, you need to bring institutions, governments, officials into the discussion. And they are there, mainly since, as you might have heard about several times, but mainly from 92, at least explicitly from 1992, with the so-called Earth Summit in Rio, which is called the Rio Summit, on sustainable development. 92 is really the first time when the UN bring proactively, so anticipating it, civil society into the loop of a big UN conference. France has been quite also active in providing some resources for civil society to have a parallel non-governmental summit side to side with the official negotiations. Everybody has heard about the Rio 92 summit, I guess. Okay, that's where we started. The international community agreed on several things, at least for the first time, on a strong analysis of the problems. And for the solution, there were the idea to create a Earth Charter. I don't know if you have heard about that they failed to agree on the Earth Charter, but some civil society actors developed and created a broad coalition that moved on with the idea of having an Earth Charter. So officially there is something existing trying to that have been enforced and enriched by other initiatives like the People Treaties, etc. But there is some actors that are still in the spirit of the Earth Summit 92, trying to make alive this ambition to have a kind of international constitution that would protect our humanity and the planet. What is less known than the Rio Summit is the five following international conferences that followed in the spirit of the 92 kind of impetus or new kind of dynamic, with a strong participation of course government and civil society. Few of them are You might have heard about the Beijing Platform, which was a UN conference on women and gender equality, very important. There was the Cairo conference on population. There were the Stockholm conference, or Copenhagen, I'm not sure which city, but it was on social development. So one of the pillar of sustainable development. Very important conference that failed in a way and led to the MDGs. I will come back to that later. And I'm forgetting a couple. But there was, during the 90s, like five structuring conferences that tried to assess the state of humanity at a global level, bringing different dimensions into the negotiations. Absolutely key when it comes to the new sustainable development goals. If you don't take those conferences as the basis for what happened last year, you just missed where it's come from. The third step we had at international level in the framework of the international negotiation. I forgot to mention the one of the first one, which is we'll come back later if you want, which is the Brundtland, the prime minister from Norway that led a commission that issued a report in 87 that has been a little bit the diplomatic initiative that led to the Rio summit, which is called the Brundtland report. If you want some reference, it's still a big reference in the international community. Brundtland was the name of the prime minister from Norway at that time. But the following step, after this series of five conferences, starting with Rio and failing in 97 in Copenhagen, has been what we call the discussion, negotiations around the Millennium Declaration. So the idea was, at the end of the century, to get the international community being a little bit more ambitious around the main challenges of the world, human society and nature. It was just before the 9/11, which is important to mention, even if one of the conferences has been just after, but all the process started before. We consider that If this Millennium Declaration, which has been agreed in 2000, would have taken place 3 years later, we would have never reached at world level the level of ambition that we had. Because it's really shifted the international priorities since 10 years now into more security-related issues. But at that time, there was still this aspiration of the international community to reach an ambitious agreement on environment, development, poverty, etc. So the Millennium Declaration have been the political framework endorsed by head of state that framed several agendas. The Jobbok Summit on Sustainable Development, explicitly namely on sustainable development in 2002, and immediately part of it, the so-called MDGs agenda, the Millennium Development Goals agenda, which has been not so ambitious, but the agenda that have been agreed at that time, that ended the 31st of December 2015, as you might know. So that was, who has heard about the MDGs? Yeah, I asked you already that, most of you, some of you, not all. So the Millennium Development Goals have been driving most of the international efforts in fighting poverty over the last 15 years. And most of the international aid have been channeled through those objectives, goals, and agendas. So this is an important milestone, of course, the Millennium Declaration, the Jobbok Summit on Sustainable Development, and the MDG framework. It would be too long. If you are interested in a more specific assessment of those MDGs, I'm happy to bring it, but our chair and timekeeper remind me that there is 30 minutes, so I prefer to go for the overall discussion and then we might have more time to detail whatever you want. But that's an important framework because the sector I come from, the so-called Global Solidarity, International Solidarity NGOs, are mainly following and trying to input and assess this agenda since 15 years. So for us, at least, environmental NGOs, I think, are not very interested by this agenda. Climate negotiations are much more important for them. But for my sector, it has been structuring very much our advocacy and campaigning work. And finally, after this negotiation, the last stage, the one we are in right now, is the so-called Sustainable Development Goals agenda. Yeah? And what is at stake with the SDGs, something I think we achieved, not everything we wanted, but few things have been achieved. One was to overcome this very old-fashioned divide between developing world and developed countries. Because the assumption, so we are, it's the, at the core of this difference or nuance or whatever you want to call it, is the broad debate I introduced to you about what does it mean sustainable development. And depending on the perspective you take, there is very different meaning. One of the wrong assumptions, I say wrong because it's our point of view, has been that there was a developing or a developed world and an undeveloped world, and the normal evolution of the world was that the developing world should develop as us. That have been the assumption part of society, not just our politicians and the UN or the big actors. In the mindset, perhaps still today, of most of the elites, institutions, leaders of the world, the idea is we represent the right development model, and there are countries that need to reach it. And what can we do to help them to reach our wonderful society? That's what is really the DNA today of most of those agendas. So NGOs are questioning this for decades now, and we manage a small step forward in making the new SDGs agenda universal. Universal meaning that it's not anymore as the MDGs, Millennium Development Goals, the developed world which is supposed to help the developing world to develop, but it's a common agreement where each country, including France, US and Japan, need to achieve some goals to transform their own society. Okay, so that's one of the major issues we managed to get on the table, agreed. So now it's an international agreement. We can talk about the way we will enforce or not be able to enforce the international agreement. As many of them, they are nice declaration on paper, but there is no justice to make it enforceable. But nevertheless, it's agreed at the highest level of our states through the UN. So it's universal. If you look at the list, I will read very quickly the list of the 17 goals. The MDGs used to have 8 goals. So we duplicated, plus one, the number of goals, which is, from some of my friends from the Anglo-Saxon world, again, a stereotype, too broad. And if it's too broad, you never achieve anything, which might be a good point. But on the other hand, going from 8 goals to 17, you have a picture much more comprehensive on the problems the world is facing. And also because those goals are much more interrelated than the previous agenda, which was very much putting issues into a box of experts, of sector, education, health, etc., without creating the link between nature, health, food, anger, etc. Okay, so the new agenda is much more comprehensive with a long list of 17. So I go very quickly just with the big title to give you an overview of what SDGs are about. First goal, end poverty in all its forms everywhere. I think I don't have in this paper the full, let me find the right paper. Because the printing, I had a printing problem with my printer. Okay, end poverty in all its form everywhere, goal one. End hunger, achieve food security and improve nutrition and promote sustainable agriculture. Number two, ensure healthy lives and promote well-being for all at all ages. Number three, ensure inclusive and equitable quality education and promote lifelong learning opportunities for all. Number four, achieve gender equality and empower all women and girls. Number five, ensure availability and sustainable management of water and sanitation for all. Number six, ensure access to affordable, reliable, sustainable and modern energy for all. Number seven, this was absolutely absent, the energy consideration from the other previous agendas. Promote sustained, inclusive and sustainable economic growth, full and productive employment and decent work for all. Number eight, here in the wording you can find typically the positive impact of the trade union campaigns and the more lefty movement I mentioned at the beginning that have been pushing for 20 years for the decent work wording, which is there in the agreement now. Nine, build resilient infrastructure, promote inclusive and sustainable industrialization and foster innovation. 10, reduce inequality within and among countries. Very important, that was one of our key elements. You might have heard about the report released by Oxfam International recently on inequality. That's Oxfam is the visible part of the iceberg in our sector, one of the strongest development NGOs, but we have been pushing, most of us, for now more than 10 years on this question of inequality, which came very, very well with the report of Piketty at international level that made also some a little bit of buzz around those issues. The World Bank started to talk about inequality levels 10 years ago, but in a kind of silent at that time. So this is now part of the goals, reduce inequality within and among countries. 11, make cities and human settlement inclusive, safe, resilient and sustainable. 12, ensure sustainable consumption and production patterns. 13, take urgent action to combat climate change and its impact based on the UNFCCC, that was the name of the acronym I was looking for this group of experts. 14, conserve and sustainably use the oceans, seas and marine resources for sustainable development. This was part of another, what also the international community tried to do is to put back into a single framework some other agreement and convention that were existing. For example, the one on oceans, there were a lot of international agreements, but again in a box is a small agency with no resources trying to deal with those issues, and now they are back into the main framework, supposedly the main one. Oceans was the number what? 15, protect, restore and promote sustainable use of terrestrial ecosystems, sustainably manage forests, combat desertification and halt and reserve land degradation and halt biodiversity loss. Not sure you got it, but I had to read it three times to understand all those things. But again, it's a way to capture many small agreements that exist on desertification of land use, food, etc. Then you have the 16th, which is promote peaceful and inclusive societies for sustainable development, provide access to justice for all and build effective, accountable and inclusive institutions at all levels. Well, with that, you know, you have a different word, radically different, but it's important to have this issue part of the things, because it was, from our perspective, civil society, a way to counterbalance the more security-oriented responses of the international community to bring back the question of peaceful societies, etc., and the rule of law, which is a key element of democracy. Finally, 17th, strengthen the means of implementation and revitalize the global partnership for sustainable development, which is to make all actors working together to deliver supposedly those goals. Okay, so thanks to the timekeeper, I am not reading each targets of each goals. There are 169, but if you don't read the targets, this will remain a very kind of abstract goals. So I think it's interesting for the few of you that might be more interested by the subject to go into the targets, where you see exactly what is the real ambition. No? You can end poverty, but you know, international community have developed several ways of assessing poverty. So you have extreme poverty, which is just economic measurement of $1.25 US dollars per day and per person. This is extreme poverty. And this is where the international community is focusing a lot since the last 10 years, because automatically with the economic growth today, China and India are putting out of extreme poverty billions of people without doing anything with aid and with development. And you know, you just need to push India and China to keep their ongoing economic growth without changing anything in the model. So that's why international community is looking at extreme poverty as a big priority. But the, for example, in the indicator, what we missed in the MDGs, the previous agenda, very interestingly, today you have to substantially or half, I don't know if it's measured, but to have poverty everywhere, not extreme poverty, poverty everywhere based on nationally agreed measurement. So that's very interesting, because if you keep just the UN criteria for poverty, there is no poor in France, no one, nor in the US, nor in Japan, because it's $2 a day, 1.25 you are extreme poor, two, with a family of four, you do the 2, 30, or 5, let's say, with $150 a month for a family, you are not poor anymore. So you know, it's a very low level. Now, in the new agenda, we manage, that's why we call it universal, to take into consideration what each country agreed to define what is poverty. So that kind of, that's why I invite you to look at the targets, because that's where you see that there is substantial improvement compared with the previous one. And currently, what experts and civil society and institutions are trying to do is to bring back indicators to measure over the next 15 years. I forgot to mention that this agenda on sustainable development goals is by 2030, which is, from our perspective, too short time. Could have been 2050 with a kind of intermediary milestone, midterm review, whatever, but okay, 15 years to achieve all those ambitions that you have heard. But then people are working more concretely, even beyond the targets, the indicators. So that creates, you can imagine, at world level, every country is supposed to report on those indicators that have been, that will be developed by summer 2016, that develop an industry of consultants and institution and research think tanks and, you know, people, engineers that will bring figures on the table of the OECD, of the World Bank, of the UN, to get a periodic, every 5 years, assessment of the process of implementing those development goals. So I stop there with this third package, which was from the academy, actor-oriented, now international agenda-oriented perspective on sustainable development, which might feel for, I don't know you, but certainly for most of my friends, my sister, the most boring part of the sustainable development agenda, which is the international negotiation, because usually people are not aware, doesn't understand the jargon, doesn't mind because it's so far from their own real life. So this question of, is it the right way to approach so important questions from the international community first, is a very, I think, important and relevant question. And this is why, and this would be my last statement, I have still 15 minutes, might be shorter if you want, but it's to show the multi dimensions of sustainable development. So it can be seen as an international agenda that you don't care about. You can see it from a very local point of view, which is the one that bring the civil society actors, especially the grassroots one, the one linked to the so-called Great Transition, environmental NGOs, the one I personally like very much, who are starting to assess sustainable development in the way we, you guys and ladies, behave day by day in your real life. How do you consume? How do you use your energy? How do you travel? How do you behave in terms of purchase and etc.? So that's very interesting, I think, this perspective of having a very local look at the sustainable development agenda. Since the 92, you might have not heard about it, but there was the so-called Agenda 21, which is referenced to the 21st century, which was local agenda by local authorities and local actors. So it was a little bit upper than just you and your direct environment. It was to say, okay, in each territory of the world, it should we should have some commitments from the different actors present in this community to go for a more sustainable development way of life. There is today like 6,500 Agenda 21 developed by municipalities, province, communities, etc., which is not a lot, but across 113 countries, so it's not just in our Western societies. So I think this is interesting. We could perhaps see in the future how to boost those local Agenda 21. Then you have seen, for example, very interestingly, some big metropole or state in the US in front of the desperation of some politicians to see a kind of national federal agreement on climate, to decide at state level to engage in the climate reduction, Kyoto, etc. So that's very interesting to see how some local authorities can also be very active in pushing for more sustainable agendas. You have, I mentioned it very quickly, but the private sector has to address now the sustainable development demand, because the public opinion is increasingly putting pressure on some, especially the international brands and actors, to bring a little bit of information and accountability about their impact in terms of resources, etc. So you have heard many initiatives on that, but at international level they have agreed on a compass, kind of a self-driven agreement. You know that private sector usually doesn't like to have governments or UN to impose some commitments, so they have been put into their own responsibility to develop their own set of commitments. So there is an agreement at international level that every multinational should follow on in terms of use of resources, etc. There is this lively debate around the COP21. You might have been already in France at that time in Paris, but there were all those discussions about the greenwashing, which is the criticism some NGOs are putting to the private sector in their way to approach sustainable development, which is mostly a marketing toward greening the current system and not challenging and changing anything substantial or systemic. So all those issues are, I think, very interesting. The more we talk about them, the more we make it concrete for people, the more we might get supporters within our own societies, wherever we are, wherever we live. And that might be one of the major challenge for the world after peace and security, which are the immediate, certainly, priority and emergency for many people across the globe. But in a longer term perspective, especially for you, youth and young generation, the question of reaching a sustainable world is one of the major challenge. You might have heard about this ecological footprint initiative, which is led also by some NGOs across the globe, which allow each of us to measure a little bit its own impact in terms of the number of planets we need to maintain the way of life we have. And we know that, for example, to maintain a middle class Western economy kind of way of life would request 3 to 5 planets in terms of use of resources. So the day we achieve this, there is no more planet if it's based on my current way of life. I don't know your mind. Despite all the day-by-day effort I do, if we reach that 6.6 billion inhabitants on Earth live like Olivier Consolo, that's the end of everything. The end of everything. There is no more resources, there is no more nature, there is no more ocean, there is nothing. What, clean water, nothing. So the real question that some of us, because if I said at the beginning that I use to work mainly with the so-called development NGOs, I'm more and more in my real life as an activist, part of a great transition movement or Buen Vivir, the good life kind of organization that put at the core of this debate our way of life, to reassess totally what make your life a good life and how to make your good life as dematerialized, not sure you can say that in English, as possible. Yeah, the less my good life depends on goods, production, plastics, petrols, resources, energy, the best is the future of my children. That's easy like that. This equation cannot be challenged by any serious scientist or politician today. So I think this is the major issue of the century, but I'm absolutely not pessimistic just for the sake of being pessimistic. I think we need to be serious, responsible, accurate if we can, and to push you guys and ladies to take the comment on dit ça, le flambeau, the light, and to bring it to the next step. I stop there. I am on time. Okay. Cool.
So thank you for being here with us. Thank you for your presentation. We are going to introduce quickly Millennium Development Goals to arrive to speak about Sustainable Development Goals. Then Helen is going to talk about the Danut theory and about funding for SDG and some questions. So, reading a report about the result of Millennium Development Goals, they are considered the most successful anti-poverty movement in history. And so, as you said before, they were 8 goals with really broad vision, and they last for 15 years, from 2000 to 2015. And they were concerned most of all on developing countries. And in the report, we found some progresses done thanks to these goals and some shortfalls. So I'm not able to speak about all of them, but I will just give some quick examples. For example, the fourth goal, reduce child mortality, we had really important results because the child mortality decreased more than a half. But at the same time, in the more general picture, we can say that Even if the child mortality under 5 years is decreasing, it hasn't reached achieved the goal, the target, yet. So at the end of 2015, most of all for sub-Saharan Africa, then there's Oceania, Southern Asia, and less countries, less regions are more close to the target, like Western Asia and Latin America join the target. Another example is the fifth goal, and it was improve maternal health. So maternal health, maternal mortality decreased around 45%, I guess, really quickly. But in the general vision, we are still really far from the target. Again, for sub-Saharan Africa and Southern Asia, and almost for all the regions. The seventh one, ensure environmental sustainability. There's good news that we are at 98% of ozone-depleting substances eliminated, but at the same time, we have some bad news about the emission of carbon dioxide that augmented, and it's more than doubled in Asia, and it's doubled in Southern Asia. And if we are going to see and compare developed regions and developing regions, we see that it's decreased in developed regions, but in a really short percentage, and it's more than doubled, almost three times bigger in developing regions. And in general, in the world trade, it's more bigger. So as some issues are not still solved, so still resolved, we arrived to sustainable development goals. So as you said, they are more than 8 this time, there are 17, with 169 targets. And it was a success because it was the largest consultation program in UN history, while the first, the Millennium Development Goals, it was ideated by a little group. And they are trying to connect different dimensions of sustainable development, like social, economic, and environment. Can you change, Ellen, please? Thank you. So even if they are more comprehensive, as you said, reading a report, review of targets for the Sustainable Development Goals, the science perspective, we still found some comments, some critiques. For example, according to these authors, 49 targets, so 29% of targets, are just 29% are well developed. While 45% could be more specific, and 17% requires significant work. So I took just one quick example. Coming back to sustainability, so the goal 8, promote inclusive and sustainable economic growth, employment, and decent work for all. As you said, it's an improvement compared to the previous goals, but still, what is the critique could be is the fact that we are still considering GDP to calculate growth, so it could be not enough, even because GDP, so growth measured by GDP, could have a trade-off with the environment, because to have growth we need more resources, more energy, and of course GDP will grow, but how it will be, how much it could be for the environment, and maybe we should consider more the natural capital and resource efficiency.
Yeah, as mentioned before, I want to introduce you to the DONUT theory of development, which basically helps us to assess how good SDGs are. So in this theory, there are two levels. So at first, there's the outer level, and these are the environmental boundaries. So that would be land use, climate change, and biodiversity, etc. Like it's all on. Yeah, you know what that means. And then on the other hand side, you've got the social boundaries. So for example, health, energy, and food. And it's shaped as a donut because on the one hand side, you've got the environmental boundaries, which you shouldn't cross because otherwise the ecosystem could come down. And on the other hand side, you've got the social boundaries, which you want, which you don't want to cross to the inner side. Because you want to have a certain standard of living for everybody. So if you manage to do that, there's a safe and just space for humanity, which is the circular thing. So now assessing how well that has worked out so far, it was basically put forward by Rockström and other scientists in the beginning. This would be the outer layer. And of the 9 different goals they identified, 2 have not been yet quantified, so there's no measurements for them. And then of the other 7, we exceed 3 limits. And yeah, I mean, that's biodiversity loss, climate change, and then the output of nitrogen. And what's interesting, alone, if we look, for example, at nitrogen, 33% is only caused by meat production for Europeans. And then the second level, the social boundaries and on the inside, and basically the blue parts here tell you what hasn't been reached yet, even though we've had the Millennium Development Goals before. So, and what's interesting is to see of the 13% people that still live in hunger, we would only need 1% of the current food supply to feed all of them. And then of the 19% of people down here that don't have access to energy, it wouldn't even take 1% of our current output of carbon dioxide to provide them with energy. And yeah, I mean, probably the most shocking number is that of the 21% of the general population of the world that live below the poverty line, we would only need 0.2% to make sure that they would live there. Now, did you notice donut? Will the SDGs help us to get into it? So at first, if we look at the priorities, what we see is that the social foundations are nearly all covered, and the social foundations stem from the Rio summit. And nowadays, they even added 2 things more, which are housing and transport. So in general, the priorities seem to be in that field, because if we compared it to the coverage of environmental objectives, we see that it's really patchy, and that only the 4 things up there are specifically a focus of a goal, while the other things are only included in the targets. Yeah, about the ambition. As you would guess, the social targets, which are already more pronounced in the priorities, are often linked to very strong ambitions, just like ending poverty by 2030, while the environmental targets only have a few things that are absolute and time-bound. So, for example, ending overfishing and halting deforestation by 2020. And there's even 2 very key ambitions that lack target dates. So that's stopping biodiversity loss and to combat climate change. And as I mentioned, these are the 2 dimensions of the 9 dimensions of the outer boundary, which we already succeed. And also there's some measures that remain unclear. For example, how to, they say that we should minimize the impacts of ocean acidification, but there's no set date, and also there's no they didn't determine yet how to measure that. Yeah, and lastly, and that's connected to what Alexandra has already mentioned, these goals stick to a sustained economic growth. And that's only compatible with this donut we've seen when, or like a rising GDP is only compatible with it if it's recoupled with poverty reduction and decoupled from environmental degradation. Now, if we look at the targets, to be more specific, target 8.4 is to endeavor to decouple economic growth from environmental degradation. And obviously, endeavor is not very strong legal speech, but it's very debatable if that will change a lot. So, as a resume. The social boundaries look way better than the environmental boundaries. Yeah. Last but not least, about the funding of the social of the SDG. Sorry. We've heard about that before. So we, in theory, all OECD countries agreed to spend 0.7% of their gross national income on development aid, but so far only 5 countries actually do that. And if we look at the general level, 2014 was a record year with $135 billion spent on development aid, while it would have been $400 billion if everybody was really spending their 0.7%. But now some research has shown that it would need 1.5 trillion extra if we were really to succeed with the SDGs. You could calculate that the developed countries have agreed to spend 100 billion extra to help the developing countries with climate change, but still that doesn't change the fact that it is basically 1 trillion completely unclear. And 1 billion being super optimistic if all the countries were to pay their 0.7%. So what they say now is that the rest of the money should be gotten from tax revenues in developing countries, which should rise, then lower black money transfers and higher private investments. So this leads us to our questions. Do you think that the success prospects change with both developed and developing countries being involved in a process, which is one of the major new things? Then do you agree that the situation looks better for the social boundaries than for the environmental boundaries? And this is also connected to the fact after all, none of them are legally binding. So how would you assess which of them will be prioritized? And what do you think is the optimal time interval for such a set of goals? I mean, you already mentioned that before, but yeah. And then fourth, some people claim that the goals were considerably watered down in the very last minute due to the lobbying of worried governments. So for example, a famous thing being the US wanting an endeavor instead of a stronger word. So how do you assess this kind of lobbying, and what do you think about the private sector's influence? Because, for example, in connection to the last questions, do you agree that it needs considerably more funding than this target that already exists? If we say, for example, that we need more private investments to help with development, you could also be afraid that private funding would have more saying in what to invest. Thank you very much.
Well done.
Yeah, so you can head there, and we'll leave the questions up so you can refer to them.
And then back to the room, that's right? Okay, so well done. I think it's a very interesting presentation, more structured than mine, perhaps. So I might be using, if it's open source, I might refer to your presentation in further sharing. I will do because it's well done, really. The question as well are quite accurate. Should we go just following the question, that the way you used to do? Do the success prospect change with post-developed and developing country being involved in the process? Well, we'll see in the next few years. But what is really important is to stop or to overcome this divide between country that would perceive they are right in terms of development and country that would be wrong. And the fact to put all the country over the same level of duty and responsibility to address the new challenges, I think create in the international community a kind of new dynamic. A lot of developing countries we have been in contact with were really sick, are because nothing has changed yet, sick about and tired about the language of donors vis-à-vis recipient countries, you know, this kind of power relation that exists between today the donor community, to make it short, represented by the OECD members and other groups of countries like the G77 and the emerging economies on their own, etc. So it's really, I think, bringing everybody back to its responsibility and then being accountable to its own citizens. I think this is also very important because in France, for the moment, the feeling was French government is only accountable to French citizens vis-à-vis the aid transfer. We'll come back to the funding issue. Now they are supposed to be responsible by an international agreement, even if it's not binding in the way we would like it, but it's an international agreement, and France is supposed to go through a path toward more sustainable patterns. So it's give leverage to go much deeper. And then also it break this kind of bubble. My sector has been enclosed or enclosed themselves, which is the international NGOs looking at the state of the world totally disconnected with the national local agenda in France, to give the example of France. So it's reconnect environmental NGOs with international NGOs, with human rights NGOs, with women organizations. So I think potentially the new SDG agenda should lead to more cross-sectorial partnership and alliances across civil society organizations, for sure. It started at European level, for example. We started to build much broader coalitions to monitor the so-called SDGs, with a strong focus on monitoring European economies, what we have never done before when it was part of the MDG framework. But we'll see, because the power relation, in some of the targets that you mentioned, that was very good that you highlighted some of them, when it comes to this more equal relation between all kind of countries, you have one of the target, which is to increase the role and decision making of developing country within the international institutions. As you know, today the shareholders of the World Bank or the IMF, it has slightly improved over the last few years, but it's still very much led by donor or Western economies. So you need to rebalance also the governance of those international institutions, which is ongoing, but now there is a target which might allow, hopefully, to go further. Do you agree that the situation looks better for the social boundaries, the environmental boundaries? Oh la la. This is, from my perspective, an impossible question to answer to, because what we are perhaps learning today is that both approaches are very much interlinked, and a lot of social problems are linked to environmental problems. In the real life of real people across the world, there is a direct connection increasingly about their social exclusion, their precarity, their access to resources, to social net, to social protection, depending on the environmental struggles where they live, their access to land resources, to clean water. To so in a way, I think we need also to overcome a little bit this divide. Now, the nature, by definition, has no voice in itself to defend its cause. So that's part of the society, like environmental NGOs, environmental actors, ministries, etc., that are trying to make the case for the environment, but it's always a kind of homocentrous perspective on the issues. I have no clue. I used to say the planet is not in danger. People on the planet are in danger. Planet will survive. I'm a biologist. I have no doubt at all that whatever we do, even nuclear kind of disaster, the life might change, might reconstruct from another perspective, but will not disappear. The one that will disappear are us and some other species. But the concept of planet is in danger, it's a very anthropocentric way of looking at things, in a way, not to make it a little bit provocative. Optimal time interval for such a set of goals. Alors, you mentioned rightly something I've forgotten to mention at all, which was the inclusiveness of the process for setting the new agenda, the so-called SDGs. So 2 years of processes, we have been launching a big campaign called Action 2015, we have been organizing a lot of national so-called consultations where civil society have been invited, you know, but let be very concrete. As even in the best scenario, when there is an open process led by the UN, what do you have? You have one conference somewhere in a capital, in Guatemala or in Paris, where few hundreds of people in the best scenario, certainly more few dozens, perhaps few hundreds of people, are invited over a period of 3 months through the website of the UN that nobody knows to fulfill an online survey, to give an opinion on this. Some NGOs have more resources to deliver some reports that will be informing the negotiators. We have done that perfectly well. Yeah, there was an high-level panel chaired by David Cameron, with a group of 20 experts. Two of them were representing civil society. We have been advocating or lobbying, depending on how you want to call it, them as much as we could. It seems to be inclusive. We were there. But who are we compared with the awareness of the wider society of this agenda? Just to try, you are the future elite of the world, and you had no clue about this agenda, and not because you are stupid, because it's irrelevant, almost, for your future at that moment. So the question of being inclusive, making it participatory, I think is the key question. So the question of the ownership on this agenda. As far as this agenda remains the agenda for few thousands of NGOs, even few, like 3,000 to 5,000, few experts in governments, few thousands, well paid to follow those agendas, and specialized journalists and few research centers that live from the aid industry, this will remain a failure. The question is, how do you create ownership on those issues all across the world, in real words, with real people, real actors, economic, social, non-social, consumers, etc. And for that to happen, I think the way is much longer than what pretend the agenda on the paper. So you might need just 15 years, which is the length of the agenda, just to reach a modest level of awareness on those goals. These have been it's a permanent struggle for all civil society, how to make this attractive to normal people. Really, would you have attended this conference if it was not compulsory part of your epoch, master, whatever, in your own country? Try to imagine, you know, you have in your website what to do Wednesday afternoon, among to go to the cine, to do something much more concrete, social work, or would you attend a conference on a sustainable development goal? David said yes, so at least we have one interested candidate, but seriously speaking, I think we need to make those issues much more comprehensive, accessible, concrete for people, and to show to many actors and people, individuals, that they are part of that process, and that agenda won't be achieved by others, by just policy frameworks or no. It will be achieved by the way people behave and engage in democracy, engage in their community, etc. So it's a, for me, it's a minimum 50 years long agenda, minimum, but it might be even a little bit longer. Doesn't matter at the end. Everyone needs to be modest to do its own part of the work. Be the change you want the world to be. Huh? It's Indira Gandhi that said that 50 years ago, and I think this remains the most important piece of philosophy when it comes to activism or NGOism, which is be the change you want the world to be. Beyond that, there is nothing really sustainable. Some people claim the goals were considerably watered down in the very last minute due to the lobbying and work. to be frank, I think sometimes we just, including NGOs, oversize the importance of those negotiations for the private sector. They are there, not very active, because they are invited. Some are interested, but because they know it's not binding, they don't fear at all this kind of international agreements. And they set their parallelly to those international official negotiations and submit and blah, 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 and talks. They set their own policies and set of values and frames that they need for their business. So if you see, for example, the discussion on the TTIP, you had a conferences, or you will have tomorrow. Tomorrow on the TTIP, you will have someone from CEO, from the... I'm happy to say that I know better your program of conferences than your dear coordinator. Because it's tomorrow, you have someone coming from Brussels, from a corporate European observatory. That will be a very interesting piece of discussion, I guess, knowing her. On the TTIP, this transatlantic negotiation. I mean, the private sector today is almost reaching the point of creating, as we all know, private justice to deal with economical conflict in trade relations. Yeah, this is much more powerful than to write a very nice document on goals that everybody can agree with. They are shaping a private justice system that do not need government and institution to give justice. The privatization of the justice to deal your conflict as economical actors. This is much more powerful as real politics than whatever we discuss today. And this is the DNA of those kind of free trade agreements. You have been in Brussels, no, last week, or it was not the same as students? Most of you have been there? How was that? But did you meet Karin Ilmer a little bit? But anyway, so you have heard about this free trade agreement and how the history beyond those free trade agreements. But so I think back to the question, the private sector doesn't need to be very active or defensive within those agendas, those ones, because they do not represent any threat for the moment. That's why for NGOs, the real challenge is to get the public opinion on board. When I start, and I say me, because despite all this supposedly awareness I have, thanks to my lovely job, I'm still buying some jeans, enfin jeans on say en French, pants, hein, who are décolorés, comment tu dis ça, who are, do you speak a little bit French? Who are depaint, who are not fully colored, okay? To obtain that kind of color of my new pen, there are some people that work with sand under high level pressure in Turkey and Bangladesh, etc., to uncolor my jeans in conditions, healthy conditions, which are just terrible. After 30 years old, those people are removed to another sector of the industry because we know that if they do that 5 years more, they have some respiratory problem forever because of the polvo, of the la poussière, the dust that it creates and all the chemicals. And I still buy the same kind of pen. This is my real power. The day I stop, and we all stop to do things that harm those objectives, then private sector will start to be wary. But if I don't do that as a consumer, they don't mind of all this conversation. So the way we behave as consumers might be today, in the system we are, the main element of power I have vis-à-vis the private sector. And that's why the fair trade movements are trying to get to that point with launching a lot of campaigns, etc. But we are so far to a point of real responsibility consumption, responsible consumptions. We are so far from that. Most of the desserts we eat every day are part of a bad business chain. I've been prepared by the society, French society, by my parents, who invested both society and my parents in my studies to work with agribusiness. And when I started to discover the reality of dessert markets, banana, orange juice, and sugar cane, which was my three kind of long-term internships I did in Mexico, South Africa, and Costa Rica, I decided to stop down and to step down from what I've been studying for 6 years. Because the reality of those markets are exactly the contrary of everything we are talking here. And I still, I buy now bio banana, but I know that's not perfect as a market. There is still a lot of things to do. The big major companies, most of them from the US, of bananas are doing bio. They still buy because they are less product, but the condition, the social boundaries are still terrible for the people that work in the banana companies. So there is many, many things that we can do in front of the private sector as consumers. And as far as we do it, they are not worried at all. A little bit serious as a response, but that's unfortunately the reality of that question. Final, very important, money, the funding issue. So you were absolutely right to raise that kind of double, triple language. There is really here kind of a masquerade, kind of joke. First of all, how can we still have around the table, back to the first question, the developed world and countries, OECD countries, talking eyes to eyes to the rest of the world, 150 countries, saying that they will achieve the 0.7% of GDP, our GDP, for aid cooperation. When, as you said, we haven't delivered this commitment for 45 years. The first commitment has been taken in 1970, still not delivered. And as you showed in your slide, that means $300 billion a year that are lost for aid cooperation when they were committed to per year. So do a little bit the sum. From the 70s, we were supposed to reach the 0.7%. So 300 per year for 40 years, who has a good way of calculating, a lot of trillions have been lost as a way of redistributing. It's not a question of helping, but redistributing investment, financial flows to other parts of the world. So that's the first issue. This is a joke. We won't deliver, we haven't delivered, and this won't change. The second joke is the foreign direct investment. The foreign direct investment, which is in front of the failure of our state to deliver aid commitments, to say, this is complex, now there is the crisis. So the crisis has been wonderful for us in Europe. The confederation I led for 11 years, we were leading an annual pan-European report on aid levels and commitments versus the reality of aid. So we have been engaging in advocacy and campaigning over, still today, on those issues that I know a little bit. So our countries failing to deliver this commitment have been moving the focus to private sector, saying, okay, the crisis make now impossible to achieve this commitment to increase aid cooperation. So let's create better conditions for direct foreign investment by private sector into developing countries. And I've heard, I will never forget the opening of the so-called Development Policy Forum of the UN in Luxembourgo, where we were a couple of experts, 100 experts. The person that opened was the finance minister of Liberia, one of those African, Western African country, the number two of the government, to meet experts, that took his time to deliver the song that international institution asked him to sing, which was, guys, we know that aid will be very difficult for you to deliver. Please make sure that your business will invest. And we are opening fully our country, and we are doing everything to make the investment environment have as welcoming as possible for your business actors, blah, 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 kind of open discourse for foreign direct investment. But Liberia will never receive, Liberians can do whatever they want, they will never attract high level of direct investment. That's just, it's not even not a joke, it's a lie. I mean, that might work for India and China because of the already high level of technology, market, internal markets they have. But for the least developed country at least, this is really bullshit. So this, you cannot expect that it will compensate the very low aid level. So the third, and perhaps for the moment last hope we have, is this long-standing campaign that we have launched already 15 years ago, so-called Tobin tax campaign or Robin Hood campaign, the name has changed, but really to have a very small amount in percentage terms of each international financial transactions that goes into the funding on all those goals. And that would be the easiest way to do it, the best way. It would be absolutely unpainful for the real economy, because we know that 60% of those international financial flows are just virtuals. So that would be the response. an estimation shows that it could bring few hundreds billions, so more, few times more than the 8 current levels. So that would be, theoretically, there is now a working group of experts working within the OECD on this in 5 years. It's technically feasible, but there is still a lot of political reluctance to do it. And in some part of the world, Western countries are even opposing it. But Europe could start alone. So this is still a battle that we need to win if we want to mobilize the resources. But there is even worse, which is the fourth pillar for funding those issues, which is to stop the tax evasion. It's not evasion, it's avoidance from most of the international firms, multinational firms, that are avoiding, sometimes legally, even not illegally, but legally, avoiding to pay taxes within the country where they realize the value. Because you have perhaps never discussed who is fixing the international currency, comptabilité? Accounting. Who is fixing the international accounting rules? Is it the UN? No. Is it the OECD? No. Is it democratic elected body internationally? No. It's a group of experts nominated by the private sector that jointly elaborate the international accounting rules. And within that rules, they have forgotten to declare in each country where they do profit, how much profit they do. So they do most of the international trade today, and you can ask that tomorrow to the specialist, I am not a specialist on trade, is done intra-group. Not externally with the rest of society, but that most of the trade and value chain is made intra-group. So Coca-Cola, when they do, I lived 8 years in Guatemala, when they do Coca-Cola in Guatemala, they don't declare the money, the value they create in Guatemala, except a few things. Most of it is directly connected to holdings that are mostly in tax havens to avoid to pay the right level of taxes at the right level of value. If this accounting rule would be changed tomorrow, it would create an approximation of half a trillion, so $500 billion a year available for national budget in developing countries. 5 times the 8 levels, just because our international, multinational would pay the right level of taxes at the right level of territory, as the medium-sized enterprise pay in the same country, the small and medium-sized Guatemalan firm pay the level of taxes. You don't need to change anything in the legal tax framework of Guatemala. Just need to make sure that Coca-Cola Guatemala pay the right taxes to Guatemala, and the same for Bayer, and the same for McDonald's, and the same for... And this applies also for France. So this is the easiest way to make available for governments fresh resources to implement these sustainable development goals, which are one of the basic contributions to a national state, not just tax on consumptions paid by individual people, but part of the effort need to be shared by the private sector, and especially the international private sector, the one that then create the value, Total, the energy firm, petroleum French firm, made 10 billions of benefit in 2014. 10 billions that they should have certainly be transferred, half of it, to countries all over the world where they haven't paid 1 cent. Because most of the level of taxes of those international firms are few millions per country, because there are always some revenue that are need to be paid. That's just unfair, economically distorting competition with local actors. So it's there is no economical rational to defend this absolutely unfair situation between national business and international business in a national market. There's no one single economic argument. So I let that for your consideration, but I think within a kind of epoch master, the one you are having the luck to be in, I think you need really to go deeper with specialists, but I am not, to go on this issue, which is one of the main issues for many subjects, including the funding on all those new international challenges, climate and poverty and environment, etc. Mr. Chairman?
Go ahead and open up to questions. We usually take a couple questions and then go up.
I have a specific question concerning goal number 9 of the SDGs. I don't know if you could maybe try to answer it for me. I've asked this a couple of times already. So goal number 9 is build resilient infrastructure, promote inclusive and sustainable industrialization, and foster innovation. And when you start reading into it, basically when you look at the targets and everything, they don't define what is resilient infrastructure. They don't really define what is sustainable industrialization. When you go, they have a few examples, and it's usually related to the agro industry because they're talking about sustainable industrialization in developing countries, which most of them don't actually have an industry. So it's agro industry, right? And they're basically I have some examples that are like getting youth involved in mining and producing bioproducts and that kind of stuff. And then you have this third part of the same goal, which for me are three parts that are not related, which is the foster innovation. And like if you look at the targets, the measurements, all of the measurements for these goals, they're all related to the third one. So it's foster innovation. So it's basically measuring how much of R&D you're spending in each country and boosting R&D. And I just wanted to ask you if you could talk a little bit more about this, because why they came up with this goal that is so bizarre in the sense that it doesn't specify anything. And there are three objectives that are not really related. And about just talking about what you were saying before on the FDI and how if you're a country that's lucky enough to be able to attract FDI and a foreign company comes to your country, they're still probably not going to really conduct any R&D or at least real R&D in your country because it's all centralized in the headquarters. So what would they mean by innovation in this sense? And it's all about boosting it in developing countries. So,
do we want to grab another question?
Hi. I would like to make a question and then just ask your opinion about, just make a point about something you said. First, my question is, it seems to me that many of these problems we are talking about, it's because of all the focus is on GDP growth. All the countries, they are oriented towards the GDP growth. So, and I read an author, and I don't remember the name of him right now, but he said that the issue is that we are so focused on growth, like we have the resources to have a good living for everybody, but developed countries, they imply this focus on growth because they don't agree on redistributing their resources towards the rest of the world. So I don't know if you understand what I have to say, but do you think that this focus on growth, it's because it's somewhat related to the refusal of the developed countries in redistributing their resources? And that's my question. And so just, I'm not sure if I understand right, but you made some criticism about the international standards towards the goals. And I just want to make a counterpoint of that, because sometimes I think the countries have an incentive to put lower standards on their like environmental and social standards, because it's a way of them to achieve it more easily and to get legitimacy to being re-elected, for instance. I'm going to just take an example of Brazil, that we have a higher, a very high rate of inflation, and the poverty line is not adjusted for inflation. Like, it's an arbitrary poverty line, and it's not adjusted for inflation for like 5 years. And when it's adjusted, it's much lower than it should be. So much of the reduction in poverty we have seen probably is a statistical effect. So I was just wondering if you, what you think of that also. Thank you.
I would have a question regarding the consumption. So basically you mentioned about your consuming habits, and I think it's not only your case, but the case of most people in developed regions, that we consume much more per capita than the developing countries. And but at the same time, in the developed countries, we are the ones advocating sustainability, right? So it seems a little bit that we're not giving a good example, but we are expecting that the developing countries and everyone, we're advocating that we should live sustainably, but we do not do that. But at the same time, I think we all realize that it's quite difficult, if not impossible, for people in the developed countries to change their habits of consuming, because we need now a computer, sometimes two phones, so we need all these things. And my question is, where do you find this middle way in which people in developed countries can reduce their consumption so that they give a good example to the developing countries, and if this is even possible? So basically, where do you find this middle way?
I've been listening carefully on the four questions, but and I will recapture everything you said, but in one sentence, what was the core of your statement? Just for, because I've been lost in the with the last question, I should have taken notes before. Do you remember the main point of your? Yeah, the goal nine. That's why. That's okay. I remember perfectly what you said. And your first question before the level of poverty in Brazil. Yeah, gross. Yeah, the indicator, gross indicator. Sorry, I'm just a little bit tired. I've been waking up very early because I live in province. So let's start by goal nine. Something very interesting to do, because it's a new agenda, would be to track a little bit who is beyond each goal and each target. I think I will see with friends, colleagues, organizations if we could do that kind of work. Where did it come from? Which was a little bit your first question. Because in some parts of the agenda, I can track easily some NGOs, as I said, or trade unions, etc. On other, I have no any indication where it's come from. So that's a good example, the infrastructure. But certainly somewhere, some civil society actors or academy, whoever, have said, if you don't address the question of infrastructure, you might never reach anything which is sustainable when you see the level of resources which are invested in infrastructure. And then it came as one of the goals. So you have the people that initiate or make sure that there is a goal on something. We think it's important. And then you have the people that lobby the detail, and you are more aware than me about the indicator discussion of this goal. You know, I've looked at the targets, but I've never gone deeper than that. So you seem to have look at it better. So that could be also interesting to track the devil being in the detail, to see a little bit who is beyond that. But what I can extrapolate a little bit from your questions and the reading of the goal and targets is that what a sustainable economy should favor in the future is everything which is short chain of actors between most of infrastructures are built either by private consortiums, local authorities, cities, etc., or national governments, and the actors that come to do the infrastructures. And today, most of the infrastructures in developing world are made by developed big firms. Most of the road, as I told you, I've worked with the UN and the EU embassy, the European Union embassy in Guatemala for many years. Most of the procurements, when they were like international competition for building a road, etc., was won by Italian, French, US, Japanese firms and companies. So one of the attempts here is to challenge an international rule which exists today, which is to have a free international competition for any kind of procurements. I am a school in Uganda. Today, Sodexo, which is a French group, major number one in Orsol, food Orsol, how you say, outsourced, how do you call that? Food provision, but you know, for communities like schools, like hospitals, like all these kind of communities. It's the world leader. Could attack the school in Uganda that would not allow Sodexo to present an offer. Even if the mayor with the community in a small village would say, we have some food producers for the canteen, I'm talking about the food in the lunchtime in the school, would say we want to give a priority to our local farmers because it's a good food, it's produced the kind of food that the people want in this territory, it's affordable, perhaps not the cheapest, but not the more expensive. This is forbidden. And of course, Sodexo is not interested by one school in Uganda. But if the Ministry of Education in Uganda start to call for service provider for fooding the schools in a big region, then it's impossible to exclude international firms. When I read the goal number 9, I see the beginning of a discussion on if this is really fair. And it's fair to ask in France as well. If I want my children to eat more bio food produced locally because I want to limit the kilometers or miles that the food will do between the producer and the school of my children because of the fuel impact on environment and sustainable development, as a citizen of my small village, we are 1,000, so it's easy to put a group agreeing on that. I could impose to my mayor to make sure that the food is done by local provider. Today is illegal. Is illegal. Sodexo will attack my municipality, the one I elected. So this is just an example with full food for school, but you can take it with 1,000 examples in providing medicine, in building roads, in providing any kind of services or goods for any kind of administration, institutions, etc. So here, when no time to go into too much detail with one goal, but I see the beginning of give the opportunity to some local authorities to assess the externalities of providing food services, etc., to facilitate the participation of local and national actors first. So that's why they talk a lot about national industry, national actors, national providers, etc. No, to give a priority. And of course, the borderline is to come back. The risk is to come back to a nationalistic approach, the one I don't like neither, which is to protect everything, to make impossible for better product, better innovation to move from a country to another into your place. So I think this is where, again, the devil will be, which is how to create some more positive condition for local providers without creating feudalism 3.0, which would be a new way of being a totally nationalistic, defensive in terms of innovation, etc. The second level of your question is about innovation and how innovation is moving across the globe. Again, today there is a big challenge, which is the copyright thinking. Yeah? Beyond the copyright protection, which is an evidence for any economic actor, there is a barrier for many actors on Earth to take an innovation or some technology and to apply them without paying royalties or even having access to them. Sometimes they could pay, but they won't have access to it. So the question of creating innovation which is open source is absolutely critical. It's not mentioned here at all, but we work with NGOs and civil society which are absolutely convinced that a way to bypass the traditional actors will be to create innovation which is free of copyright, open source, in the framework of, perhaps you have heard about, talking about the commons, which is a new movement, the commons between the market and the state. It would be a third way of managing knowledge and value, which is the commons. So there is a lot of literature on that, and you can look at it. It's very, very interesting. It's a battle since decades for the local native population, this protection of the innovation coming from their own natural resources. So the new medicines that are provided by new plants, new trees, this is also a big question. You know that there are chemical firms who are putting copyrights on new molecules, you say molecule, new chemical components that are existing in nature, that was known by native people, of course without any protection, and who are copyrighting the use of those products, which we know might be the medicine of the 21st century. So all beyond the question of innovation, there is beyond those discussion, infrastructure, innovation, etc., there is something you raised in your slides, which is the decoupling, you say that in English, le découplage, decoupling of economic growth and environmental impact. So the assumption most of the economical actors today say, we can agree with this agenda because we'll invent with the innovation. We'll invent all the product we need. So back to your question, what is a way to be to consume differently? So there are some people who are fairly convinced that we will invent everything we need with three times less inputs in terms of resources. So if my cell today need calcium, whatever mineral in one quantity, they say, don't worry guys, in 10 years, by innovation, we'll do the same cell with three times less, okay? Nobody has a crystal ball, but there is a very interesting book which challenged totally this découplage, the decouple of innovation versus economic growth, which is done not by a lefty guy, NGO kind, not at all. His name is Timothy Jackson. He was during 6 years the chair of the Sustainable Development Commission of the United Kingdom. He was appointed by Tony Blair to go into all those questions for 6 years with the best academic actors, researchers on Earth. During 6 years, they produced very, very technical reports. And based on this work, the guy issued a book which is called Prosperity Without Growth, which is really super interesting because his economic demonstration is that the découplage will never be totally reached. So we can imagine that we are more, less intensive in terms of inputs in the future, but we won't manage to share by 10 the watts of the light I use when there is a need if we want everyone. You know, 1/3 of the world's population, 1/3, 2 billion people have no light at home, electric light. So the need are huge. If you want the rest of humanity to have a fair life, a decent life, the access of resources that those people need is just huge. So that back to your question, no? There is no way, if we keep the level of consumption we have, to allow those people to access even 10 times less than me. One light. They need one light. Girls need one light to study at home in rural areas over the world for 1 billion people. I have certainly more than 30 in my home. So the rational, which is very Western oriented about the progress. I am an engineer, so I believe in progress in terms of technology, etc. But this assumption that everything we need will be invited by us, especially in the next 5 years, because we need it now, is, I think, a real bullshit. And this need to be, again, transformed by the way we think, the way we... It's not just the way we consume, or it's also the way we think. What is terribly difficult for me, again, to not judge anyone else, because I don't know you, and you might be much better than me, I'm sure, but it's really to deconstruct what I've been enculturated forever. If I want to understand what is at stake with this debate, I need to unlearn everything the people that love me, like my parents to start with, have tried to put in my mind. If I don't deconstruct that, I cannot have a kind of relaxed attitude with all those issues. Immediately, I will be like some of my best friends, very defensive, because it's questioned everything I am, everything I do, everything I learned, everything they told me the world was. So it's very important to have a personal journey on all of these issues, not just to read books, etc., but to create our own path. I'm almost 50, and so I'm not very early kind of, you know, consciousness. Anthony might be a person much more, much younger for sure, but certainly more conscious about those issues at an early stage of his life. So everyone will reach that stage when it can or she can, but I think it's important to go into that personal journey and to reinvent a new way of being happy. And back a little bit to the growth indicators, I'm trying to link a little bit your three questions. There are not hundreds, but dozens of work that have been done on the indicators. well-being indicators, human development indicators. Even the United Nations, who are not the most progressive people, have developed for decades now the human development indicator, which is more than just growth. It's calculated. It's 10 years now that they monitor worldwide this human development index. But nobody yet seriously want to take on board this experience, knowledge, capacity, expertise, and even data who are existing worldwide seriously to propose to us in the media another way of measuring our well-being. In Istanbul 7 years ago, the EU, the European Union, invested in a 400 participants international conference on well-being index. Things wonderful have been done. And nobody else, after the conference, I don't know what happened. I asked several times to commissioners, to people, politicians, what happened? Some of them were there. Nobody have talked anymore about this subject, but there is a lot of things done already. More anecdotically, you have some countries that have developed, like the small Ombudsman, you know, comment s'appelle? Le Bhutan, who have developed this well-being index also. So again, if we are talking about human capacity and innovation, the problem is not to develop new economical equation, and it's really because it questions so much the way we measure things. I was the director of a European Confederation. I decided to change my life and to half my salary per two. This is the gross, voluntary decision. But this, for my circle, is just incomprehensible. The day I say to my parents, I will stop, when I was at the peak of my career, when international organizations were calling me to come, etc. I said, no, I will be back to the roots and the grassroots. And the nobody understood, because we are mindset with growth. So it's not just our system. It's not just the bad firms. The way you assess your success in this master depend on qualification, which are about improving your results. So everything is based on that kind of assumption. But it hasn't been like this for humanity forever. Now, this is a lie. If you look at philosophically what most of the old philosophies are saying about human society, the way of assessing your capacity in society, etc., was much more complex than just having good salaries, good position, good money, good car, a better house, and every time to improve it, and it's never big enough, and it's when you have stopped to pay one, then you buy the second one. And I mean, this is super recent. There is nothing that prevents the next generation, you guys, to change that. But of course, it won't happen in one day. And your last question was about the level of poverty. I'm not sure. I'm not really an expert about the way we measure poverty in different countries, but. Yes. Okay. I was questioning the international standard of the World Bank, because the show of figures, which is there are 2 billion poor on the planet, which is already a good figure. 2 billion inhabitants are poor, based on the World Bank internationally agreed criteria, which is the famous $2 per day. But, and I wrote an article on that recently that nobody, The Guardian, didn't want to publish, which was questioning the bottom billion approach, which is the extreme poor that I mentioned. No? In most of the literatures, you will see that we are fighting with goal MDG goal number one, the confused poverty and extreme poverty. Of course, for my sister, it doesn't make any difference that you say extreme or not. But in the real life of people, it's a huge difference. So today, most of our aid organizations are focusing to the extreme poverty, which will be overcome, as I said, automatically by the emerging economies like Brazil, China and India. The real challenge is to take the at least the poverty levels, which are internationally agreed as $2 a day per person, 2 billion inhabitants. But then it excludes, it means that there is no poor in my country, no poor in Russia, no poor in America. So that's just unfair. The reality of the figures, if it, you take the nationally agreed poverty level plus the international one, plus the people that just have no access, even if they have an economical capacity which is perhaps regular, but with no access to basic health and education system, you have 4 billion of people today that do not live a decent life. So that changed everything. That was, I was writing to The Guardian. I can't live in a system where 1 billion people are left aside out of 6, 15%. It's like in France, you know, we are 20% of poor people. The system can work with 20% of people excluded from the system. I'm very cynical, as our decision makers are. I can live with that. 80% are living a decent life. So if you take those figures, the overall system can go on as it is, because there is only the bottom billion people, and for them, you don't need to change the core of the system. You give aid, you do charity. I'm an assumed Catholic, so we do charity. We give money in the Sunday after the Mass, And you know, so that's philosophically, it says a lot. Now, if you acknowledge that there is 4 billion inhabitants on the planet that are not living a decent life, that questions the core of the system. Because if the system cannot deliver for the majority of the world population decent condition, access to minimum standards of life that we experiment in our daily life, you as me, then the system is wrong. And then the conclusion and the way you work as an NGO or as an institution or as an elite, as an academy, etc., is totally different. So your question about figures, it's absolutely key. And we need to take poverty as it is, a multidimensional and not just economical reality, which include on the top of the revenue available for you, the access to services, rights, citizenship, etc. That's to be poor, it's to be excluded from your society, not depending on the size of your car. So that's a terribly important question and discussion. I stop there. J'arrive même plus à dire quelle heure il est là. 5:30.
Looks like, yeah, we've got time for another round. So.
Linking to this last thing you said, I have a question. When you say that it started to think differently, that we are not thinking and following that the developing countries should follow the path of development of the industrialized countries, and this growth needs to be different. So how important do you think is the dimensions and the initiative of South-South discussions, especially in a sense when we don't think in this, like growth in GDP, when we think, as we were saying, like change some minorities' reality, like access to basic services, they are not maybe achieving a high level as we think we it is, and we think they should have, but just change this minority's reality. So how important is this South-South discussions?
Hi, my name is Teresa. I would like to know if you perhaps know the reason why it's virtually inexistent any kind of vegetarian meals in Paris, because I've been trying to go to any French restaurant. They don't have any vegetarian meals, or here, even in the canteen, they don't have any vegetarian options. And I would like to know if that's any rule or anything that, or because I don't believe that could be like a cultural thing, because even in Brazil or Argentina or Germany, most of the places that you go, you can find at least one option. And I don't know, because I also read that the government, for instance, in canteens, they force people to eat at a balanced meal. But I don't know why a balanced meal needs to meet, like, needs to be meat, and if there's any kind of movement to change this.
If you want to go ahead and respond to those two.
If you want to put one question,
I did have a question.
It's the last turn anyway, so someone else has a question, but otherwise I have a question. Not about you.
You have a question?
Yes, I have some.
I also have a question. If this
okay, so then you'll finish for the last question. No, first, maybe a question for the students. I mean, if they want to maybe go and work in the NGO field, what would you recommend? Because you have a very rich experience going abroad, doing very different things. So it can be also interesting to have your point of view on the situation now. So if someone here wants to be involved in the future in working in an NGO, what would you recommend? So.
Looks like this is the last question. So when we were talking about the 0.7% target for giving from rich countries, I started jotting down some numbers of how much that would cost, particularly for the United States. And it looked like we could have funded 10 years of that with the bank bailouts, about 10 years of that with financial stimulus, and 30 to 40 years of that with the war in Iraq. So as far as just how small that number really is compared to the total runnings of government, what is it that makes it so hard politically to hit that target? And I guess the sort of political side that I'm thinking on this is, even when you look at some of these progressive heroes like Barack Obama or Bernie Sanders, this isn't an issue. This isn't something that really gets any press time. And I guess I think you hit on that a lot as far as how do you make people care about this. But I just wonder sort of where does the hope come from on that, as far as, is this something the political system could make an issue? Is this something that people just won't ever care about? Or is there some kind of NGO, civil sector coalition that might be able to do something about this?
Okay. Alors, the South-South discussion on the importance of what we call the South-South cooperation, which is a trend to break down a little bit this North donor recipient kind of bad pattern that aid have set over time. I think there are perhaps two aspects to your question. I'm very confident that South-South cooperation can be very positive, a little bit in line with what you started to mention, which is to look for innovation, social innovation in providing health services. Yeah, I started working in the health and education field, in the field, so I remember that the ambition to have a doctor fully, as we understand a doctor, fully formed and blah, 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 for every few thousand inhabitants is almost inaccessible for many rural areas in poor countries. Okay, so to invest in a voluntary, very basic health staff based on traditional medicine and things like that, it's much more efficient than to wait 50 years to create the condition to have one doctor in each village. So you have, as a concrete example, on the bilingual education, which was another field where we used to work with, there is very little, perhaps with the exception of the Basque country, to learn from Europe. So South-South cooperation of how you deal in the formal education system at an early stage with the bilingual, if you want to rescue native languages as we try to do everywhere in the world, then there is certainly much more to learn in South-South exchanges and cooperation than North-South. Okay, so I think it has a lot of value, and this is just two examples, but I think we could draw hundreds of examples. Now, what I don't like with too much focus on South-South, which is sometimes even the trend of some of my friends from thousand civil society organizations saying we need South-South cooperation and nothing else. I have two problems with that. One is it prevents us to learn from them, because at the end of the day, we know that the struggle we are also facing in terms of providing for all in our own society, education, health system, etc., might be reviewed. Well, for some country like France or Germany, it might be a very tough political issue. But for example, again, because I have some family in law in the US, so that's why I take those examples from the American society, but not to reinforce the stereotype of French people and versus US. But you know, because of the health system are not yet universal, then they could certainly learn a lot on the way Brazil and other countries have addressed this question, perhaps to implement other kind of policies. So I think there is a North-South need also for the North that we should maintain or create. And secondly, because as someone said, an author, the North is everywhere and the South is everywhere. So the question of, it's not anymore a geographical question. Everywhere on Earth, you have 5 to 20% of the population which lives as North. And in some of our northern countries, you have an increasing part of our population that live like South. So South in terms of course, access to revenue, education, etc. The precarity, no, in terms of housing, in terms. So in a way, the South is in North, and the North is everywhere on the planet. That's big firms, and especially luxury firms, les firmes de luxe, have understood that the North is everywhere. They are the big cars and the big clocks are sailed everywhere on planet, not anymore just in Europe. So or the U.S. So we need to go a little bit beyond this old way of looking at our societies. The second question about the I like it. I'm laughing not about your question on vegetarian, because I would be tempted to give the floor to David Flachet, that I know to be a defender of meat, and then to this young guy, Anthony, who is very straightforward defensor of vegetarian only food for as a solution to many of the problems we raised. And I think with all the respect, but Anthony is right. But I eat a lot of meat myself. So you're right, there is a cultural question. Again, everything which is cultural, it's much longer to unlearn. That's exactly what I was talking before. So you need to go to a pro. It's not your rational only. It's not just. It's not because someone like Anthony can explain me why all the inconvenience of eating too many or even a little bit of meat are that I will change my consumption tradition. So it's something that have to go with your personal journey, but also with the social. If you are in social events where everybody is having some meat, it doesn't help to. Of course, if you are in restaurants, you feel totally guilty to ask for a vegetarian meal. So there is a lot of things to change in terms of policy, of community, of private life, in order to get those ideas a little bit trickling down in society. So you're right, in France there is a strong lobby. I've been working for a former trade union organization long time ago, and I can tell you that the lobby is very strong, also because in any country you have part of the agriculture field that is non-proper for anything else than grass for meat. So for example, all the central, or perhaps with biomass energy, perhaps that would be good now that there are new technologies. But 20 years ago, all the central part of France, Massif Central is called, this medium-sized mountain, you cannot do anything else than meat, cow. So if you stop that, you just stop agriculture, or you will have forest, which would be a good news. But it's another business. Normally in France, for example, you cannot change a field, a land, from agriculture use to forest use. Napoleon have put a border which is still legally totally hermetic between land agriculture destination and forest. So there is many things which are a little bit cultural, a little bit lobby, a little bit legal. That's complex. It's not just to decide at one hand of the chain to change a pattern. You need to readapt all a sector which is there. But I think increasingly there are some books, there are some TV programs, mainstream programs that defend a vegetarian approach, or at least a very low meat food as the good pattern. Because the big taboo, and just to give you an argument that you might know already, but additional, is that when you provided in the donuts the issue on the gas emission, after the CO2 and perhaps even before the CO2, the methane is the most dangerous gas for comment on dit ça, les effets de serre, comment tu dis ça en anglais, comment tu dis effet de serre, gas à effet de serre, sorry, greenhouse, sorry, I just lost the terms. So for greenhouse emission, methane is even more dangerous than CO2, and methanes are mainly produced by cows all across the globe. So that's terrible, terrible. But where are you coming from?
Brazil.
Brazil. And you feel that even over there they are a little bit more advanced?
Yeah, I think they're much,
which is a good news.
I don't know in the entire Brazil, but at least in Rio, there are at least some restaurants that
Yeah, that's a good news to hear. That's where we need back to the north-south to learn more about how did you manage to face that, because culturally, as you said, Brazil and Argentina, that I know a little bit, are very strong meat tradition. So if it's possible over there, it should be possible here. Hopefully, with French, we never know. And the last question about, there is two last. I will hand, because the time is running, with the NGO question that David very professionally put forward for you guys. But first, your 0.7. You are absolutely right. And thanks to raise so clearly that 0.7% of our GDP for international solidarity is peanuts. Is peanuts compared with all the kind of spending that you mentioned. Wars are a little bit an extreme, but anything we do, even subsidies to fuels, energies, and etc., it's peanuts. You know, we are talking about 100 billion. So of course, if I talk to my sister, my grandmother, about 100 billion or billion, she might have forgotten how many zeros it means. But it's start to panic people. But compared to the world GDP, which is 60 trillion, so 60 or 70 now, 70,000 billions. So you have to always compare those 100, which is the current level of aid, to these 70,000 GDP, world GDP levels. So it's really peanuts. We know even in the US, we can all agree in the OECD that to have a fair state that plays its role locally and federally, you need at least, not like in France, 55% of the GDP, but at least 25 to 30%. You need to mobilize at least 30% of your national wealth and to reinvest it into common goods, public services, to get something that is reasonable. So 0.7% compared with anyone with a little bit of honesty would acknowledge that we need to get a fair society. It's really a huge gap. But because we just talk about billions when it comes to aid and never about the real cost of the other cost of life, people are just afraid by that figure. That's something we have evidenced. There is another thing, which is the terrible question of accountability. I've been working perhaps the UK NGOs are the most advanced organization in trying to answer the good question you put forward. Why it's so difficult to advocate for this 0.7 if it's small amount? One of the arguments of politicians, especially in the UK, is the accountability question. Okay? They say it's not about the amount, it's about the control of the money. And then you are back to a very, very difficult thing, which is tracking these expenditures who are hardly reaching the real people, as you might know, but out of those aid money, most of them are staying with us in our rich economies, within the administration, within NGOs, within staff salaries, etc. And the real part that goes to people is very limited. So that's something that first, when you start to track it, you raise a lot of questions in the mind of our citizens. And for politicians, even if the small amount that goes to local level in developing countries is small, the problem is they feel that they are accountable, they must be accountable for each cent. That's what we heard. Huh? And it's very difficult to track in detail each cent of the UK aid, overseas aid amounts. So there is a technical question of accountability, blah, blah, blah. And I think there is a lack of political will. And the crisis has been a good pretext. Before 2008, we were not reaching the 0.7. But since 2008, it's much easier for any politician to say, I have other priority. You know, I have poor in my own country. I have migrants that I should even, in the best scenario, you know, I need to welcome them. So better to use that money to welcome the migrant than to send it outside. You know, so it's so easy to go out of that deal. So that's why some of us, I'm not totally radical on that, but some of us are considering that we should stop aid and go for something else. And the tax system is perhaps much neutral, because it's not like the donor and the recipient and that kind of power relation between the country that gives and the country that receives. If we do like we are doing with the SIDA fund, the HIV/AIDS Global Fund, which is a new mechanism, which is not linked to any country. Of course, you have some contribution from all over the world, but then it becomes a kind of international mechanism. So you have not that kind of, the politicians cannot go and say, I want to track everything. So that's a little bit more neutral in terms of redistribution. But the question of accountability remains an important question. If you don't have citizens globally organized to track what they do, you have another kind of risk. So it's complex, and believe me, I think most of our campaigns in Europe are oriented to make the case for aid money, more aid levels within the public opinion. But we are, at the end of the day, so small. The money we put in advocacy and campaigning is peanuts compared with the money we are supposed to go to send and to invest in, at least in concrete action in developing countries. That, with the exception of Oxfam, with few reports that they managed to get into the loop of big media like Le Monde, etc., in France, or The Guardian in the UK, we have a very low level of visibility in the mainstream media. I don't know if you, in the US, how many times do you hear an NGO talking about something else which is not giving 20 euros for a child in Africa? About more political work. Very, very little. Because the donors, my grandmother, when she was alive, used to give some money, and she was giving money for the young, the children that were dying in Africa. She didn't want this money that she gave to be used to pay Olivier's salary in doing a lobby in Brussels. So it's all the business model, and back then to the question of David, the business model of NGOs, it's a tricky one. In Europe, for you to know, in average, 50% of our funding is coming from private people, donors, private, not private sector, but people, and 50% in average from public funding, grants, subsidies from the states, local states, national states, EU institutions. So it's, we all, the NGO in international solidarity represent in Europe almost six, it's not very precise, but 6 to 10 billions a year of budget, and you can consider that half of it is coming from private donors and half of it from public donors, with exception. Greenpeace, for example, in the environmental field, doesn't accept any public funding. So it's only private funding going to advocacy work, political work, no project. WWF might be exactly the opposite. A lot of public money going to concrete action. So it's a, there is a diversity of situation, but in average, you can keep in mind a little bit those figures. We are talking in Europe about few thousands of professional NGOs, just for you to have an idea of the size of the market. So when I say professional, I mean, because that was, I think, the sense of your question, having some professional staff, so paying some staff to work within their teams. So this is the size of the sector in Europe. Certainly the same size or in the US and in Canada. So you have few thousands NGOs today that are able to perhaps work with you and hire you in the future. So that represents few dozens of thousands of jobs. That's the size we have a little bit. No more than 50,000, I would say, jobs, which is good enough. It's not a totally ridiculous sector, but if you take it at international level, that's not neither a lot. But there is not just NGOs. You have also increasingly private foundations, philanthropy, which are even in Europe developing strongly in the last few years, where you could also find some interesting jobs. You have to look at institutions, because with those new commitments like SDGs, climate, etc., I think the need for well-prepared, like you guys, people that engage with institutions in those agendas in terms of monitoring, facilitating processes at local level, from local to global. This is not questioned for the moment. So I don't think in the short term those jobs opportunity, even within the UN, will decrease. I don't see that as a risk. And you have also to look at the generational renewal. The UN have been set 60 years ago, but I mean the main agencies 40 years ago. So most of the people are reaching a little bit the end of their careers. So I think they might have a good opportunity to work with the UN in the next 10 years. So that's just to size a little bit the market. Now you want more precisely the kind of profile, or David, or the kind of jobs? Oh, if you want to approach an NGO, that's a good question, depending, of course, of what you look for, where you come from. But one of the... No, it will be useless, unfortunately, but you certainly can approach the NGO to know the NGO a little bit better. So if there is some voluntary work, even by distance, you know, increasingly you can do some voluntary work, even if their headquarters are a little bit far from where you are, with the new technologies, etc. So I think it's a very good experience to work with one or the other NGOs at one stage, just to figure out how it works, what is the business model, what is the internal culture, blah, blah, blah. And that gives you an asset when you apply then for a job. You need to go for, I wouldn't be pessimistic with the online application. I mean, because I think, well, at least what I've seen so far, most of the recruitment processes are really inclusive and transparent, and they are published, most of them. So perhaps, hopefully you don't have a contradictory experience yourself, but for my knowledge, it's a good way to get jobs within the NGO sector. So go to their website, look at the job opportunities and apply every time you can. Put a lot of attention to your letter. Make it short, one page, but really a letter which is not a standard letter, not a template letter. Show that you understand what they do and the way we work, they work. Because that often the first thing we read before the curriculum. Now, if you are from a northern country, you know the dream, as I had the chance to do, to live a few years overseas within the framework of an NGO is less and less a reality, which is a good news. Unfortunately, I've been benefiting from it, but it's a good news because there are qualified people almost everywhere today. And NGOs are increasingly working with local professionals, which is absolutely the right things to do, except in war situation. And I started in Guatemala under the war, so that's why they wanted expatriate. But with that exception, it's not easy to, except if you decide to live in another country, then you go and you work with local contract, which is always an option also, which are not so bad. Huh? The local contracts of the big NGOs in Brazil, etc., are not bad work condition, even for a French young guy, huh? So or girl. So you should also consider that if this is really what you want to do. And finally, perhaps to say that I encourage every time I can, like today, all of the young people I meet to reinvent NGOs. Because NGOs are also part of a business model which is very aligned with those agendas, those actors, etc., which are a little bit aid-oriented, old-fashioned sometimes, who are a little bit dependent on those funding flows, who are, in a way, putting too much emphasis in their own brands. Because to access to funds, you need to be known by the public, by institutions. So, you know, that's create an engineering within each NGO, which is 50% of all our resources are just to show that we are good at what we are supposed to do, instead of doing what we should do. And so perhaps it's just not anymore the good model for the future. So if you could reinvent the NGO 3.0, or 21st century, I think this might be my last invitation to you, the more entrepreneurial kind of thinking, not to say business oriented, but to say invent the next civil society generation we need. So be creative, proper things, challenge the whole generation and move it. That would be my advice, and it's 6 o'clock. Mr. Chairman.